Okay, I encourage members leaving the chamber to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible. As we move on to the final item of business this evening, a member's business debate on motion 12082 in the name of Alexander Burnett on National Lyme Disease Awareness Month. The debate will be concluded without any questions being posed, but I invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Alistair Burnett to open the debate around 7 minutes. Mr. Burnett.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank members for their support in bringing my motion recognising Lyme Disease Awareness Month to debate. Lyme disease is a bacterial infection that is transmitted to humans through the bite of an infected tick. And since being elected in 2016, I've been involved in the campaign, meeting with local and national groups, including Tick-Borne Illness Campaign Scotland, Lyme Disease UK, and the Lyme Resource Centre, as well as experts in the field, such as Professor John Lambert. And of course for many patients for whom this disease affects. In preparation for this debate, as in previous years, I've written to numerous organisations asking what they were doing to raise awareness. And I'm delighted to report on the improved distribution of information to staff and the wider public, and the following should be applauded for their efforts. Ramblers Scotland, Public Health Scotland, the Cairngorms and Loch Lomond National Park Authorities, Forestry and Land Scotland, and Scottish Forestry. Also the Woodland Trust, who are working with the University of Glasgow on an initiative to monitor and test ticks for Lyme disease at Moncrieff Hill in Perthshire. I'd also like to commend the Lyme Resource Centre, who are running the Light Up for Lyme campaign this month, which will see sites lit up in green, such as Edinburgh Castle, the Kelpies, and Marshall College in Aberdeen. And they've also implemented signage and QR codes to report tick sightings and bites. So credit where credit is due. For increasing the distribution of materials to GPs, pharmacies and public centres, and the government's PR activity to help spread information. However, whilst there has been progress, it would appear that this is now under threat, as I understand that funding for the Scottish Government-led Lyme Disease Awareness Raising Group has been reduced. So I have a number of questions, which I hope the Minister will answer in a response today. The first of which is to ask the Minister to confirm how much was spent last year and what they're proposing to spend this year on awareness campaigns. And secondly, what analysis is the Scottish Government carrying out as to the effectiveness of these campaigns and the justification for any reduction? Because funding also impacts research. The James Hutton Institute worked on the landscape and climate impacts on ticks that carry Lyme disease, but this was discontinued in 2019 due to Scottish Government cuts. And the Hutton has faced cuts of over 60% in real terms over the past decade. So thirdly, can I ask the Minister to confirm that the Scottish Government will commit to funding a research programme into tick control? Now, on to patients themselves. We may never know the number of people in Scotland suffering with Lyme disease. Diagnosis is difficult, and we've spoken here before on the bullseye rash, fatigue, and fever-like symptoms. Blood testing, however, plays a vital role, but there is only one testing centre based in the Highlands. The number of laboratory reports almost doubled in 2021 to over 500, yet the Scottish Government has no plans to set up regional blood testing centres to reduce pressure on this single resource. And similarly, more medical professionals need training in recognising Lyme disease, because early treatment is vital in preventing long-term debilitating effects such as joint pain and swelling, nerve problems, heart issues and chronic fatigue syndrome. And I will take this opportunity to note that there will be a virtual film screening of A Red Ring, A Journey into the Heart of Lyme Disease by filmmaker Jonas Berkel, documenting his own experience of the disease, as well as discussions with other patients, researchers and doctors. Yeah, certainly.
Brian Whittle.
I'm very grateful to my colleague for giving an intervention. Would you agree with me that one of the big problems with Lyme disease currently is the perception is that it's a disease in the north of Scotland through the Heather and the Highlands, and actually many GPs and many people down this end of the country in the middle don't understand that Lyme disease goes right across the whole of Scotland?
Alexander Burnett.
Thank the member for that intervention. Absolutely. I think the Lyme can be found all over Scotland. And one of the problems is people from urban areas visiting, you know, and going to rural areas for enjoyment, which we all want to encourage, and getting bitten and returning to an urban area where potentially their GP doesn't recognise symptoms of Lyme as easily as a GP in a rural setting would. Now, certainly.
Finlay Carson.
I appreciate your colleague taking the intervention. Would you recognise that ticks are now far more common? And actually, just this afternoon, my daughter came home from nursery with a tick under her eye. And that's the second tick she's had in a matter of weeks. And my whole life, I've never had a tick. And it seems to be far more common. And we need to recognise that this is a growing issue and it needs to be addressed as a matter of urgency.
Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Member, for that intervention, and absolutely agree with that. I think it is becoming far more common. I think the change in weather patterns and some of the habitat being left in urban areas with grass not being cut is encouraging ticks in places where we wouldn't previously have seen them. Now, my greatest knowledge of the effects came through patients Janie and Lorraine, who back in 2017 lodged a petition to improve treatment for patients with Lyme disease and associated tick-borne diseases. Now, their petition was closed in 2021 due to some progress being made to improve resources and awareness, but also a promise to meet with the Minister. However, as myself and my colleagues will highlight today, the work to improve testing and treatment of Lyme is not over. And worse, the petitioners have not had their meeting as promised. They feel forgotten about, so can I ask the Minister to commit today to rectifying that? I met with Janie yesterday, who has made huge progress over the past 2 years, having undergone a drug protocol that has changed her life, set by Professor Lambert. And whilst this treatment is also helping many other patients, it is disappointing to hear that the Scottish Government remains ignorant of this progress and appears to have no wish to engage with these medical developments. And disappointingly, according to one of the petitioners, the Scottish Government's own advisor, Professor Tom Evans, has refused to acknowledge persistent infection and the potential impact of Borrelia on the immune system. So if such attitudes persist, how are we to start developing a vaccine? And at this point, I'd like to recognise another key player, the National Trust for Scotland, who have been doing excellent work at their sites, educating staff, and are proactive in engaging with the public. And in particular, they are supportive of the development of a vaccine, VLA-15, the only active vaccine against Lyme disease in clinical development, which is in phase 3 clinical testing in America. Now, in 2022, the Scottish Government said, and I quote, "This is an exciting development, and we will continue to support vaccine development wherever possible." So can the Minister confirm if she is still excited and what she has been doing to support development of that vaccine since that letter 2 years ago? Because other countries like America are moving ahead in their understanding and research of Lyme disease, helped by Finland, Germany, Sweden, Poland, and the Netherlands, amongst others. Yet this SNP government is not only ignoring evidence, but showing no interest in learning and reducing funding for those who would raise awareness and carry out vital research. Scotland's enlightenment is now under a shadow, and the progress will not be made unless the government are open-minded. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Burnett. We move to the open debate. I call first David Torrance, to be followed by Alexander Stewart. Around 4 minutes, Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Alexander Burnett for securing this important members' debate this evening. Lyme Disease Awareness Month is crucial for spreading knowledge about the dangers posed by ticks and the potential serious health risks of Lyme disease. As someone who has personally dealt with the nuisance of ticks on my dogs, I can tell you these little critters are not to be underestimated. The key to keeping ourselves and our families safe is awareness and knowledge. By getting to know our adversary, we can mitigate against the risks posed by them. As we have heard, ticks are tiny arachnids that feed on the blood of mammals, birds, and sometimes reptiles and amphibians. They might be small, but the impact they can have on health is massive. These ticks are found in grasslands, moors, and forests, essentially any areas where there is a dense vegetation and abundance of wildlife. They are carriers of various diseases, and most notably being Lyme's disease. Lyme's disease is caused by bacteria, which ticks can transmit through bite. If left untreated, Lyme's disease can lead to serious health problems, including chronic joint inflammation, Lyme arthritis, or neurological symptoms. It is not just the humans at risk. Our furry companions can suffer too. The risk of contracting bacteria is very low if the tick is removed promptly by using the correct technique. The current research is showing that around 10% of ticks in Scotland are carriers of Lyme disease. So not all ticks are carriers. However, in Scotland, the risk is particularly high. Figures reported that there are around 1,000 cases of Lyme disease reported annually, but the true number is likely to be much higher due to underreporting and misdiagnosis. Scotland's dense woodland and rich biodiversity create a perfect habitat for ticks, increasing the likelihood of tick bites during outdoor activities. I want to share my personal story about my personal battle with ticks. My dog, a lively golden retriever called Buster, who you may know better as a former Holyrood Dog of the Year, loves nothing more than running around playing in the woods and roaming about in the long grass. Unfortunately, this means he is a prime target for ticks. I remember the first time I found a tick on him. Buster loves to come camping with me and the Scouts and often spends entire days running in fields, darting out of bushes and swimming in the river. Late one evening, I noticed something unusual as I was giving him a thorough brush. My hand brushed against a tiny hard lump near his ear. On closer inspection, I realised it was a tick embedded snugly in his skin. Now, removing a tick is no simple task. It requires patience and the right tools. As we all know, thanks to Lyme disease Awareness Month, you have to be very careful not to leave the head behind, as they cause infections. I fetched my trusty tick remover, a handy little gadget I carry everywhere with us, and sometimes I recommend every pet owner have. And with a bit manoeuvring, I managed to extract the tick in one piece. However, that is no mean feat. I don't know if anyone has tried wrestling inside a tent with a stubborn 7-stone retriever, but my advice is don't. I now found a tick control collar that seems to work perfectly for him, so it's very rare that he now has any ticks. But on these odd occasions that he does, I can't help but worry about the potential Lyme disease. The concern extends beyond Buster. It's a risk for all those who enjoy Scotland's beautiful outdoors. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, it's clear that education and awareness are the best tools in combating the dangers of ticks and Lyme disease. It's important to spread this knowledge, especially to those who might be more vulnerable, like children and elderly, who are more likely to spend time in tick-prone areas without realising the risks. Let's take this month to educate ourselves and others about risk associated with ticks. Share information, check your pets, stay vigilant. It's important that this information is passed on in a practical and positive way, which is easily understood to allow people to educate and protect themselves as they make informed choices. By doing so, we can reduce incidence of Lyme disease and ensure that outdoor adventures remain safe and enjoyable.
Thank you, Mr Torrance. I can assure you that tick removal on a Springer Spaniel is no easier than it is on a retriever. I call Alexander Stewart to be followed by Martin Whitfield. Around 4 minutes, Mr Stewart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be speaking this evening and would like to congratulate my colleague Alexander Burnett on securing his members' business debate. As we've already heard, Lyme disease is a bacterial infection that can be spread to humans through infected ticks. Unfortunately, we are seeing more and more of Lyme disease across Scotland. And as we know, the diagnosis and treatment of the disease can be difficult and complex due to varying symptoms. And these include fatigue, flu-like symptoms, as well as the telltale bullseye sign, which can cause a rash. It is becoming much more prevalent across parts of Scotland, and we've heard that already. And I have supported this in the past, Deputy Presiding Officer. Recently, I had the opportunity to be reminded of this when I attended the Lyme Awareness event here in the Parliament, and I had the privilege of meeting with a school teacher, Pauline Bowie, of the Lyme Resource Centre. Pauline was bitten herself while she was a university student back in the late 80s, but it has taken decades for it to be diagnosed, and she went through extreme pain, the symptoms, discomfort, before it was diagnosed. And that is one of the biggest issues we face here today, is that the diagnosis is still not being processed properly. And we need to commit to playing our part here in this Parliament, but we also need to ensure that the government is playing its part to ensure that detection is seen as a priority, and that has sometimes been a problem in the past. The Lyme Resource Centre is a registered office in Kinghorn within my own Mid-Scotland and Fife region, and it operates virtually, so the charity is an excellent service accessible, especially online. And the opportunity for this charity to run with a number of trustees, number of volunteers and clinical advisers are there to try and support individuals, and they give their time freely and voluntarily to help that. And I wholeheartedly commend their tireless work and the work that Pauline and her colleagues are doing, because it reinforces the commitment that we need to do all we can to make that awareness. Another aspect of TIC, Deputy President, over is bracken control. Now, we've already heard and acknowledged that the Scottish Government have not authorised the use of Hunlex and their purpose for doing that. And that has created and continues to create some difficulties for us going forward. Among others, the National Farmers Union talked highly and they were really disappointed that the Government banned the use of this because they see it as an opportunity to deal with a positive way of recognising what's happening on the hillside, because without that there's the possibility that farmers, crofters and health becomes a major issue for many parts of the community. So I think it's vitally important that we assess some of that and we look at the possibilities, and I hope that the Minister may come on to that in her summing up as to what is being done and what we can achieve. So in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, we are absolutely aware of where we are with Lyme disease, and we've heard it's taking place in other parts of the country and other parts of the world who are detecting and trying to manage this most effectively. Likewise, I look forward to hearing what will be taking place, because it's important that we check the growth of the tick population. And as I've said before, I very much hope that the Minister can commit to evaluating and elaborating on what is going to take place, because it's what's happening now that's important. We know what's happened in the past, but we need to ensure that the future for this disease is being managed effectively. And at present, that seems not to be the case, and has already been discussed by Alexander Burnett. We're talking about funding issues, and they need to be managed too, to ensure that we have the funding that matches the ideas that we have to take forward, and they will be very paramount, and I look forward to hearing from the Minister on that. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Martin Whitfield to be followed by Evelyn Tweed, around 4 minutes, Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it is a pleasure to contribute to this evening's debate. And my compliments to Alexander Burnett for securing this time in what is a very important month, and a month that this Parliament has noted significantly in the past. And I know that the member, Alexander Burnett's interest in this, indeed goes back to 2016 and the discussion that he had about the petition that is now unfortunately closed. But I would echo the importance of this Parliament and this Scottish Government honouring offers representations that were made to petitioners to this place, and in particularly a meeting which has not yet taken place, because I think it is important that those who come and open up to this place with their lived experience, their proposals, their ideas, their campaigning, their bringing to the public knowledge the risk with regard to, in this case, ticks, are honoured and respected in return with the offers that are made. So I hope that that can indeed happen, because I think it would be disappointing for anyone to have to go back round the circle of a petition to try and get something that has already been promised. Now, that's perhaps a negative note, and I hope it can be turned to a much more positive one in the Minister's closing statement. And it is true to say, and if I can castigate Mr Burnett slightly, with regard to the geographic location with regard to ticks, because the reality is that this is a danger across the whole of Scotland. And in the south of Scotland, where we have considerable rural areas and also forests, the occasioning of tick bites, ticks indeed with regard to attachment to pets, and then subsequently moving on in the home to individuals, unfortunately frequently children, probably because of the ferronite tasting skin than perhaps some of us adults have, is a genuine risk. And from the challenging statistics that exist, it would appear that there is a 5 times higher risk than the 850 cases in Scotland, closer to 2,500 cases across the whole of Scotland that may exist, some of which are going without diagnosis. It would also be unfair of me, having championed the member who brought this date, not also to mention you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and your considerable contribution in this debate last year, because I think one of the areas that is underrepresented is the workers and the risk that they take working in the countryside, and particularly in the south of Scotland in respect of forests. It is well known that wooded areas, particularly with the inclement and slightly damp weather that we have that's visited us today, that that's almost the perfect recipe for an explosion of ticks and consequently the explosion of risk to workers in forested and wooded areas. And that steps have been taken by those that work in the forestry area quite considerably about trying to alter behaviour, because actually the reduction of ticks we've seen has been challenging in open countryside. It is almost doubly challenging in wooded and forested areas, particularly where there's an intensity of deer, which, as one member has said in the past, are an absolute tick magnet with regard to it. And so those that work in our forestry and wood are required both to have the knowledge of ticks, but also to undertake a change in behaviour to measure and understand their risk of exposure, which, unlike perhaps those who take to the countryside for enjoyment, where perhaps rolling up one's socks, although not perhaps the greatest protection, is a way of reducing the exposure. But the requirement of wearing safety equipment adds to the challenge that those workers in forestry have to protect themselves. And so it's also about the self-care, which speaks very strongly to David Torrance's comment about the ability to take this month for the purposes of education, of checking yourself, have a process that goes through it. Look for that rash surrounding a bite. Consider that the fever might not be a common cold. Consider the headache that you're suffering, the dizziness, and sometimes the irregular heartbeat is more than just a throwaway symptom to be ignored, but to go to the GP. And then that speaks to the other request from the opening comments, which is about we need to ensure that our medical profession in the widest scope across the whole of Scotland understand the symptoms to look for, understand the approach that should be taken, because if Lyme's disease takes a hold in a person, we know from, sadly, from the lived experience of so many people who've been to this parliament, it is incredibly difficult to control. But if caught early enough, it is much easier to disease to do. And on that point, can I thank you for your patience, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. I now call Evelyn Tweed to be followed by Tim Eagle, around 4 minutes, Ms. Tweed.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I thank Alexander Burnett for leading this member's business tonight. Lyme disease is an issue close to my heart, and colleagues may remember that I led this debate last year. I recently had the pleasure of hosting a reception with the Lyme Resource Centre to kick off the National Awareness Month, and thanks to some members already for giving a shout out to the event. At this event, we heard from campaigners who had been absolutely debilitated by Lyme disease after sometimes decades of misdiagnosis. In contrast, I've heard recently about several cases that have been caught early and where antibiotics have been administered quickly. My constituent, Heather Mackay from Doon, told me about her 8-year-old son, Aaron. He had a bite mark behind his ear and a rash that spread across his face. It wasn't the shape of a bullseye, and the GP didn't think it was Lyme's disease. Then Aaron developed a fever, and Heather became convinced that it had something to do with the bite. Within a few days, he became extremely unwell and was admitted to the hospital, where they treated him for Lyme disease. As you can imagine, this was an extremely stressful time for the family. Aaron, thankfully, is fully recovered, and I'm glad to say that his grandparents, Brian and Pauline, are with us in the chamber today. Aaron was not a textbook case, and the GP had focused on looking for the bullseye rash. Though this is a good sign to look for, there doesn't need to be a rash, and there can be no rash, and it doesn't need to be a bullseye either. In one in three cases, there is no rash at all. We need to ensure that there's an understanding that many cases don't... Yes?
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Evelyn Tweed to take an intervention, and she is right. None of these symptoms may appear, and actually it's about the importance of having had the education, listening to your body, and in the case that you're describing, obviously the wonderful example of the mum not taking the professional advice, and that it is about listening, and if you think there's a problem, keep persisting until you get the answer.
Evelyn Tweed.
I would actually completely agree with what the member has said. You have to just look at it in the round and, you know, really think about it for yourself. So catching Lyme disease early is an excellent outcome, but preventing it in the first place is even better. And members have already talked about some of these things. Tucking your trousers into your socks sounds really easy, but it does work. Or using insect repellent on your skin and your clothes can stop bites. There is still some way to go. The Lyme Resource Centre have recently shared results of a survey which found that 42% of people diagnosed with Lyme disease in Scotland were not aware of Lyme disease at all. Many people see ticks as a risk only when venturing out into the hills in the summertime. However, one in five who answered the survey were actually bitten in their own garden. And I would agree with earlier comments on prevalence. There is some evidence that milder and wetter winters are extending the lifespan of ticks. Warmer weather is also increasing the time that people spend outdoors. These factors are both likely to increase the risk of transmission. And I'm glad that further research into this is part of the Scottish Government's Climate Change National Adaptation Plan. The Minister committed to an awareness campaign, and I was pleased to see the publication of materials recently. I call on the Government to detail how they can build on this and ensure that the public know about this changing risk. Presiding Officer, given stories like Aaron's, I am hopeful that we are becoming more aware of Lyme disease and are acting more quickly to combat it. I am extremely grateful to the 25 MSPs who attended my event earlier this month and signed the Lyme Resource Centre pledge. Together, we can work cross-party to ensure that this issue is firmly on the agenda. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Tweed. And I call the final speaker in the open debate, Tim Eagle, around 4 minutes. Mr Eagle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and many thanks to my colleague Alexander Burnett for bringing this debate to the Chamber today and for his tireless efforts on raising awareness of the issue. And can I just associate myself with the remarks of Evelyn Tweed there, that actually you're right. The thing is, there is no science with Lyme's disease, and so it's not easily obvious to spot when there is a problem, and that's why it is so important that we all here are raising awareness of the issue. I can remember many years ago, waking one morning to find the all-too-common bullseye on my leg. And I can remember thinking to myself, oh, not again, because ticks are an all-too-common occurrence in my line of work, sadly, having lived and worked in the countryside for such a long time. But this one, I must have missed. I suspect the tick had long since gone for a nice rest after feeding on me for quite a while. But the problem was I was in London at the time, on a family holiday. So I went to one of the out-of-hours GP surgery to see if I could get treatment before I started to get home. The doctor I saw at the time was confused, seemingly not knowing much about the possibilities of Lyme disease. And I imagine at the time, London was not really a hotbed of tick activity. As we were discussing, another doctor happened to walk past, though, an Australian doctor. She took one glance at my leg as the other doctor examined it, smiled and said, oh, you've got the Lyme's then. Within seconds, she advised the treatment. I had my prescription and I was away. Thankfully, I didn't come to any harm there, but I think that was because of the actions of the doctor. In Australia, oddly enough, Lyme's disease is not so much of a problem, but with over 70 species of tick, other diseases are, and their doctors are apparently very aware of the problem. In Scotland, that is where we need to be. As deer numbers increase, sheep are leaving the hills. We used to have tick mops on the hills. We don't really have that anymore. More woodland is planted, and as climate change persists, we are seeing large rises in tick numbers, and more people are becoming infected. Getting the message out about Lyme's disease, spotting the symptoms and treatment are vital, and I'm glad to see more and more primary care doctors being informed about this now. It's great to see the work of projects such as TickSolve, a four-year project involving Glasgow University, which is fantastic. TickSolve will investigate the ecological conditions that enable tick-borne infections to spread, identify areas of the UK where the health risks are likely to be highest, and put forward possible solutions. TickSolve will determine whether climate change and woodland expansion are likely to increase tick-borne infections, such as Lyme disease, in the UK. The project finishes next year, and perhaps my colleague Alexander Burnett will hold another debate then to discuss the report. As others have mentioned, the tick is just the host. It's the bacteria that is the problem. Once it's made its way inside the human body, Burgdorferi, as I understand it is to be said, bacteria hides in plain sight. It enters by the way of the tick's salivary secretions and then quickly migrates into the skin. From there, it travels through the bloodstream to other fixed tissues, such as your joints, heart and brain. Not a greatly pleasant thought, is it? As mentioned by my colleague Alexander Burnett, though, testing and treatment is key, and that's where I would like to finish, Presiding Officer, with testing. For something that can cause such long-term issues, testing actually isn't all that good. Current tests can be wildly inaccurate, even in positive patients, with false positives and negative tests being common, and tests requiring a build-up of the antibodies before it will even detect infection. It's great to hear of potential new tests being worked on in America, with Tufts University, PeterGenX and UCF College of Medicine all working on promising new testing. But I would urge us here in Scotland to be also working on that too. Persistent symptoms of Lyme's can be really debilitating, and with ticks increasing, this could become far too common. Reliable, quick-to-use tests could allow quick diagnosis, treatment and cure. It will save the NHS money in the long term and, most importantly, help people who contract this disease. I hope our research institutes have access to the funding needed to listen to this, and my call to the Scottish Government is to check that they do. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Eagle. I now call Marie Todd to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I join other members here today in thanking Alexander Burnett, MSP, for bringing this motion to the Chamber during Lyme Disease Awareness Month. I'm really pleased to have the opportunity to close the debate, although it is no longer my portfolio, given the area that I live in and that I represent, this is an area of keen interest for me. I'm keen to highlight the importance of raising awareness of Lyme disease because, as others have mentioned, it is absolutely crucial that people are aware in order that they can access early intervention and treatment should they think they have it. The debate's very timely, not only in that it coincides with Lyme Disease Awareness Month, but also we've seen a rise in cases in Scotland in recent years. And as we approach the summer months where more people are likely to be out and enjoying the outdoors, it's really important to highlight that while ticks are commonly found in woodlands and grassy areas, as others have said, they can also be found in parks and gardens throughout Scotland. We have to be mindful, and I'm Minister for Sport, I'm passionate about physical activity. We want people to get out and enjoy all that Scotland has to offer in terms of our beautiful outdoor spaces. So we need to provide information on how to avoid being bitten. That tucking your trousers into your socks, glamorous as it looks, is a very effective measure. How to safely remove an attached tick in the Highlands. And I'm sure online you can buy many gadgets, all of which are really good at helping you to safely get them out. Signs and symptoms to be aware of is absolutely key. We know that prevention is the best defence against Lyme disease. My colleague Jenny Minto, MSP, the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health, closed a similar debate on Lyme disease last year, and I'm very pleased to hear of the further efforts that have been made to raise awareness of the disease this year. I also want to pass on my thanks to Evelyn Tweed, MSP, and Lyme Resource Scotland, who hosted and sponsored the Step Into the Limelight event in Parliament earlier this month, providing an insight into ticks and Lyme disease in Scotland. The Public Health Minister and other MSPs, including myself, attended the event, along with a large number of guests from outdoor, professional and educational organisations to share their experience and expertise on Lyme disease. And indeed, government officials will be meeting with the organisation again soon to build on the work that we already do with them through the awareness raising group. A number of people mentioned dogs. Now, you'll know my Dog did not win. Cooper did not win Holyrood Dog of the Year. A tragedy and a travesty, but he lives on the shores of Loch Broom in the Highlands, which is absolutely tick heaven. So he gets preventative medicine every month to prevent ticks from lodging into him. And certainly if you live in an area of high tick numbers, as I do, that is very worthwhile, considering we've also often wondered whether humans couldn't consider something like that too. But that science is not quite there yet. In terms of research, the Brennan Laboratory, based in the University of Glasgow Centre for Virus Research, is currently researching how clinically relevant pathogens are transmitted by ticks. And they're aiming to better understand how the viruses manipulate the different cellular environments in a tick or a mammal to sustain virus replication and cause disease, including Lyme disease. The Brennan Lab are partnering with the Conversation Volunteers Scotland and the Lyme Resource Centre to develop a tick map, which you can look at and report tick sightings and bitings in Scotland. And that data will be shared with academic partners to use for future research funding and evidence. Risks to health from tick vector-borne disease have been highlighted, as others have said, in the current UK-wide climate change risk assessment. The Scottish Government is required to respond to this and has inputted towards the final statutory Scottish Climate Change Adaptation Programme in March 24. But as others have said, it is clear that climate change is having an impact on the risk of vector-borne disease. Glasgow University led the Mosquito Scotland project, which looks at precisely that issue. Of course, there is a risk of mosquitoes reaching Scotland, so there is also a risk of vector-borne disease from them. But they are looking at broader issues than that. The Scottish Government is absolutely committed to raising awareness of Lyme disease, and that's why I'm delighted that social media activity is going to run throughout this month through stakeholder and partner engagement. An awareness-raising toolkit's been distributed to stakeholders such as NHS 24, Public Health Scotland and Visit Scotland, who use this across their networks and their own digital channels, as well as editorial copy for newsletters, websites and emails. That activity will be further supported by social media across government and owned platforms. There will be another burst of activity in June to focus on childcare settings as a reminder to families and staff to be tick aware over the warmer months when they're enjoying being outdoors, perhaps responding to exactly the situation that Finlay Carson raised. Increasing the awareness of Lyme disease, including the symptoms, how it spreads and risk factors, is the key to prevention of Lyme disease in Scotland. Public communications are required not only to raise awareness, but also to acknowledge that ticks are not limited to the countryside or farms. They can be found in cities as well, as many have said. Yes, I certainly will.
Douglas Lumsden.
I thank the Minister, and apologies for pushing all the wrong buttons there, Presiding Officer. I have a constituent, Emily Gilmore, and she contracted Lyme disease along with her son also, and she's had a, you know, she was persistent, as what we heard earlier, and she didn't get any help from NHS and had to go down the private route, spent thousands of pounds on that. And now seems to be a vendetta by the NHS against her and her husband, Nick. Would the Minister try and look at that case for me to see if there's any help that the government can assist in clearing the parents' names?
What a stranger to pushing the wrong buttons, Mr Lumsden, I would suggest. Minister, and I can give you the time back for the intervention.
So, certainly, we're always concerned to hear about people who are having difficulty accessing the care and help that they require from the NHS, and regularly meet with constituents, as the member knows, who have not had the standard of care that we would hope for. Certainly, if the member writes to the minister, I am sure that he will get she will engage with him on the issues that he raises. Early recognition and effective treatment is absolutely essential to prevent those long-term health consequences of Lyme disease. And that's why we've worked with asked officials to work with clinicians and experts to look at how we could standardise treatment pathways across Scotland, with a particular focus on patients with complex or post-infection Lyme disease. We're making progress in Scotland on testing and diagnosis. The Scottish Lyme Disease and Tick-Borne Infections Lab at Raigmore Hospital, which I visited many years ago in Inverness, It continues to carry out research and development into new tests for tick-borne diseases, which will greatly improve our understanding of this complex infection. I'm sure that they would accommodate a visit from members with a keen interest in the issues. It really is worth learning more about how that laboratory works. We continue to work closely with stakeholders and clinicians through the Health Professionals Education Subgroup. The group are examining the current resources being used by GPs and considering options for additional learning and development. Finally, I feel I must raise the issue of tick-borne encephalitis. There has been identification of a probable case of tick-borne encephalitis, a potentially serious infection in Scotland last year, so clinical surveillance for that has been increased. It is really important to note, though, that one probable case is not evidence of a significant change to the risk to human health in Scotland from TBE. Last year, Human Animal Infections and Risk Surveillance Group published an updated TBE risk assessment, which states that the risk of infection to the general population in the UK remains very low. So, in closing, I'm very happy to follow up on the specific questions that Alexander Burnett put to me in writing. He'll get a response from the Public Health Minister. I reiterate that the risk of Lyme disease should not put people off spending time outdoors. There's a few simple steps you can take to protect yourself. Cover up bare skin, wear long trousers and tuck them into your socks if you're in long grass. Use insect repellent. Check yourself and clothing for ticks after being outside. I often joke that myself and my family are like monkeys picking over each other after we've been outside, but that is indeed a necessity in my part of the country. If you find one, carefully remove it using a tick remover or fine tweezers, and speak to your GP if you develop symptoms. Certainly in the Highlands, there's a low threshold for prescribing antibiotics when people present with symptoms because there is a high level of recognition. But the story that Tim Eagle described shows that it's really important that individuals have a knowledge that they might be facing Lyme disease in order that they can explain to health professionals who may not know. Thank you again, Alexander Burnett, for bringing the motion to the Chamber today and to everyone who contributed to the debate.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.